Hey everybody, hope you're all doing good and hope you're all safe. A very good evening all of you and welcome to our regular current affairs revision series. And today we'll be covering November month current affairs and this is part two of our video. So if you have not watched the part one, please go back and watch it. So quickly, let's get into the lecture for the day. If you can give me a thumbs up or say a yes in the comment section, I'll be starting the lecture as quickly as possible. Please let me know this. So are we good to begin? Yes, great. So please make a note of our upcoming events at All Aboard, which can help your preparation. One is the revision series, where we try to cover the 50 most important questions for the economic section. And this will be continuing till Thursday, and it is going to be at 6 p.m. And also, we've got this current affairs lecture series for SEBI that we're doing today, and it is going to cover phase one. And then we have the Garment Scheme lecture series for RBA Grade B phase two of the examination every Thursday at 8:30 p.m. You will find all of these links in the description box below. So let's begin the class with the first question. Union Home Ministry recently relaxed the norms for NGOs mandated to maintain FCRA account with the SBI. Foreign Contribution Regulatory Act is legislated under which of the following ministry? A. Ministry of Finance, B. Ministry of External Affairs, Ministry of Home Affairs, Corporate Affairs, E. None of the above. So, what is the answer for this question? So, which ministry takes care of the Foreign Contribution Regulatory Act? The answer is yes, beautiful. It is Home Ministry, right? So, the Ministry of Home Affairs deals with Foreign Contribution Regulatory Act. Please don't get confused here because it is related to foreign, so you might think external affairs, and since it is something related to finance, you might think finance or corporate affairs. But the answer is Ministry of Home Affairs is what is that is looking into the Foreign Contribution Regulatory Act. Next question: Union Home Ministry has set a deadline of dash for the NGOs registered under the FCRA to open an account with SBI. So, what is the deadline that MHA has given for the NGOs which have not yet opened a account, FCRA account with SBI? So what is the deadline that it mentions? So the deadline is till 31st of March 2021. So within this deadline, the NGOs that are registered under the FCRA Act have to open an FCRA account at SBI, that is the New Delhi branch of SBI. So let's quickly look at the current affairs behind it. So as you've seen, Union Home Ministry has relaxed the norms for NGOs that are supposed to maintain an FCRA account with SBI. So it has given a deadline now, giving an extension till March 31st, 2021 for all those who have not yet registered with who have not yet opened an account with SBI. So you will see that going forward, the NGOs can maintain the existing FCRA account for the utilization purposes. So this leverage is also given. So besides this extension of the deadline till 31st March 2021, it also mandates that the NGOs must give the name of the beneficiary, name, account number, address of the country, and the residence of their donors very clearly to the SBI New Delhi branch, right? So SBI can ask for the beneficiary names, account numbers, address and the country of the residence of the donors, and also all the NGOs who are getting the foreign donation will be required to submit an undertaking detailing the purpose why they are receiving their funds from their donors. So this undertaking has also should also be submitted to SBI New Delhi branch, right? So these are some of the things that have been mentioned. And also you have to note here that FCRA Act has been amended in 2020, and these are some of the key changes that we have to make a note of. So this can be asked in not just phase one, but also phase two of your examination. So FCRA has been amended, and the recent amendment, as you see, include all of these things. One is that public sector employees are forbidden to receive any foreign contributions going forward, and the transfer of funds received under the FCRA to other individuals or organizations is completely prohibited now, and the administrative expenses that NGOs can utilize the foreign contributions has now been lowered from 50% to 20%. So now if the NGOs are receiving the foreign contribution, they can use their contributions to only 20%, the 20% of which can be diverted for the administrative expenses. Earlier, they were using around 50%, right? So FCRA stands for Foreign Contribution Regulation Act. So we know that a lot of NGOs in the country get the funds from the foreign organizations. Like Greenpeace in India is also said to have received funds from abroad, from countries, right? And FCRA mainly deals with regulating the amount of foreign contribution that flows into the NGOs and other organizations within the country, right? And now, if you look at the other changes, apart from cutting down what can be used for the administrative expenses, it has made Aadhaar number mandatory for all the office bases of the NGOs, directors, or any other key functionaries which are involved in receiving the FCRA. And apart from this, the powers to suspend the FCRA registration of the NGOs is now vested with the government. So government can suspend the FCRA registration and the renewal of the registration after 5 year tenure. So whatever registration currently is there, it can be renewed every 5 years, and it is going to include the same level of scrutiny as for the case of the new applicants. And also, it has mandated that FCRA account designated FCRA account has to be maintained with the SBI Delhi branch, right? Maintain. So please note this information also. And NGOs can actually voluntarily surrender their FCRA certificate, and this is an option that is made available as a part of this new change in FCRA 2020 amendments. Next question: RBI recently rejected which of the following finance company's proposal to buy IDBI mutual fund? So, which company's proposal to buy IDBI mutual fund has been rejected by RBI recently? Muthoot Fincorp, ESAF, Microfinance, Shriram City, Bajaj Finserv, and Reliance Capital. The answer is Muthoot Fincorp. So Muthoot Fincorp recently wanted to buy stakes in IDBI mutual fund, and RBI has rejected the same. So as you see, Finance request for a no object of clearance for its proposed acquisition of IDBI mutual fund was not accepted by RBI on the ground that NBFCs cannot actually acquire a stake in the asset management companies, or they can't own the asset management companies, and also they cannot sponsor mutual funds. So, saying this condition, RBI rejected that Muthoot Finance, being an NBFC, cannot acquire a stake in IDBI mutual fund. So, one of the important facts that we have to note here that Muthoot Finance is having its headquarters at Kochi, Kerala, and the current MD and CEO of Muthoot Finance is Mr. George Alexander, right? So you might expect some questions on these lines too. So next question is: Razor Pay launches corporate cards in collaboration with which of the following companies to help the small and medium enterprises? A. Capital One, B. Standard Chartered, C. Mastercard, D. Visa, and E. None of the above. So with which of the following companies Razor Pay came into collaboration for launching the corporate cards here? What is the answer for this? It is D, Visa, right? So Razor Pay and Visa are collaborating with one another for launching this new brand corporate cards. These cards will provide relief and also help in stabilizing the financial operations of those startups and small and medium enterprises which are severely impacted because of the COVID, right? So it is going to give entrepreneurs a relief because it is going to act as a one-stop card where you can go for recurring and non-recurring online payments. And we know that Visa is headquartered in California, US. And Razor Pay, you have to know with respect to the phase one of the examination, where is it headquartered at? It is headquartered in Bengaluru, Karnataka. And the current MD and CEO of Razor Pay is Mr. Harshan Mathur. Right? So next question is: RXIL, that is Receivables Exchange of India Limited, was set up in the year 2016 as a joint venture of Dash and NSE India Limited. So, Receivable Exchange of India Limited is a venture between which of the following? A. IDBI, EXIM, IRDAI, SIDBI, E. None of the above. The answer for this question is D. SIDBI. So, RXIL or Receivable Exchange of India Limited is a joint venture between SIDBI and NSE, right? Both of them are important. Remember, the joint venture is between SIDBI and NSE. So why is it in news? Receivable Exchange of India Limited has got, it is the first trade credit insurance transaction in sandbox. So RBI has come up with a sandbox kind of regulatory mechanism where you will see that easy licenses will be given to the players to try and test new fintech products, right? So already approvals have been given for Tata AIG, ICICI Bank, and Yes Bank. Along with them, RXIL has also initiated a trade credit insurance backed transaction with all of these as the financials, right? So it is the first time Edtrade's platform tested efficacy of the TCI based transaction, improving the ability in assigning the credit limits to the corporates, right? And you have to note here that RXIL is promoted by SIDBI along with NSE. And few important details about RXIL is that it was launched in the year 2016 as a joint venture between SIDBI and NSE, and it is launched with an objective to operate India's first trade receivables discounting system, which is an online platform which makes financing of receivables easy for MSME sector. As you all know that MSME sector is cash starved or fund starved. You see that most of the payments that the clients of the MSMEs have to make to them is not done on a timely basis. To make it on a timely basis, we have this online platform called TReDS, that is the Trade Receivables Discounting System, and this is operated by RXIL, right? Next question. Recently, RBI has asked LVB to fully write down dash before DBS merger. Very, very important question. A, CET, that is common equity tier 1 bonds, B, tier 2 bonds, C, additional tier 1 bonds, D, tier 1 bonds, E, none of the above. So recently we have seen that LVB is going to be merged with DBS, and as a part of this process, RBI has asked to write down completely which of the following bonds. What is the answer for this? Good job, it is tier 2 bonds, right? So LVB's tier 2 bonds has been asked by RBI to completely being written down, right? Well, let's do know about this in detail so that you can answer both in phase one and also phase two. Firstly, a quick fact with respect to phase one is that DBS is headquartered in Singapore, and the current MD and CEO of DBS Bank is Mr. Piyush Gupta. So we all know that LVB is going to be now amalgamated with Singapore-based DBS Bank, and as a part of this process, RBI has asked the LVB Bank to fully write down around 318 crore of its Tier 2 bonds. So this has been happening because CARE ratings for LVB's Tier 2 bonds as of October has gone down very, very badly. It has given a B rating for the Tier 2 bonds, and B rating implies that these instruments will have high risk of default, and that is the reason RBI has asked to go for complete write down of Tier 2 bonds. So a full write down implies that the investors in these bonds will not be receiving anything, right? It's a complete loss for all the retail investors too. So in case of Yes Bank, if you have seen already, Yes Bank has also undergone the same process, and in case of Yes Bank, RBI asked the Yes Bank to write off the AT1 bonds, right? Remember this. In case of Yes Bank, it was the additional Tier 1 bonds that RBI has advised to be written off. In case of LVB, it is the Tier 2 bonds. So here we have to note that whenever RBI is going to come across these point of non-viability, right? Whenever banks are coming to this point of non-viability, PONV stands for point of non-viability. Whenever banks come to this level, RBI can actually ask the banks to write down their Tier 1 bond, as you see, AT1 bonds and also Tier 2 bonds, as you have seen in the case of Yes Bank and the LVB Bank. Let's know what is this point of non-viability in the first place. So you will see that during a point of non-viability, decision that the conversion or write-off without which the firm would become non-viable. That is one case. So without a write-off, the firm will become non-viable, and also a decision to make an injection of the capital or a support without which the firm will become non-viable. These are the situations when such kind of events will be triggered. And apart from this, also, whenever there is a reconstitution of a bank or an amalgamation of a bank with any other bank under the Section 45 of the Banking Regulation Act of 1949, even that also will be deemed as a point of non-viability, right? These are all the cases where RBI can take the decision of writing down bonds, right? That is the same case as you see in case of Yes Bank and also the Lakshmi Vilas Bank. So you have to understand here that there are different tier one capital. One is the CET capital and the other is the AT1 capital. And as you look at the loss absorbing nature, it is tier one has got less loss absorbing nature when compared to tier two. If you look at tier two, it has got subordinated bonds, perpetual subordinated bonds. All of these are going to be falling under the tier two capital of a company, and it is more loss absorbing, so it is comparatively less risky when you look at the tier one capital. Tier two is less risky, but despite being less risky, LDB has been advised to write down its tier two bonds, right? So you must know here that RBI has opened up these tier one bonds and tier two bonds to retail investors about 6 years ago, with certain condition that the investors will be understanding or educated with respect to the risk of these bonds. Only with proper education of the way the bonds work, that's when retail investors have been allowed to buy these kind of bonds. But after the debacle of the Yes Bank, SEBI has made the restriction with respect to the participation in AT1 bonds. So no more all the retail participant can be easily participating in the AT1 bonds. Only qualified institutional buyers are now allowed to participate in the AT1 bonds, and the minimum allotment will be not less than 1 crore of the size in AT1 bonds, right? So not it is now restricted the retail participation in AT1 bonds, and it's only going to be available for the QIBs, that is the qualified institutional buyers. And with LVB's episode, a similar kind of thing will also be possible in the near future with respect to the tier two bond retail participation also, which is now open for all retail participant, right? So with this, you will also see that probability of the participation in tier two bonds might also be changed. So I think we've covered in detail for both phase one and phase two, and you can answer with respect to that question. And let's take the sixth question now. Which of the following became the third most valued domestic firm in terms of market capitalization? A. Infosys, B. TCS, C. HDFC Bank, D. ICICI, E. None of the above. I think it's a very simple question. What is the answer for this? It is C. HDFC Bank. The Reliance Industries Limited, after the TCS, now HDFC is becoming the third most valued domestic firm in terms of the market capitalization. So it is the third firm whose market capitalization went past the 8 lakh crore, making it the first domestic lender, right? As a part of the bank, as you see, it is the first domestic lender to achieve this feat. So even before HDFC, as I've told, RIL and TCS have crossed the market valuation before. Next question. GST collection touches an 8-month high of over dash crores in October. So what is the collection of GST in the October month? And it has reached an 8-month high. Very important and possibility to be asked in phase one. How much is the GST collection? Yes, good job. And it is A, 1 lakh crore. So GST collection touches the 8-month high of 1 lakh crore in October month. Please remember that, in which month. So it has crossed 1 lakh crore and is now standing at 1.05 lakh crore. And out of this gross GST, the contribution of the central GST is around 19,193 crores, and the state GST contributes around 5,411 crores, and the integrated GST contributes to around 52,540 crores. Right, so make a note that integrated GST is having the highest contribution. If they are asking about the arrangement, so first comes the integrated GST having the highest share, and then the CGST, and then the state GST, right? And as you can also make a note of the cess here. Cess has contributed around 8,111 crores, right? So cess is going to be part of a very important component here, and you can see that it is contributing more than state GST. Next question. Saudi Arabia's public investment fund is investing $1.3 billion to pick up 2.04% stake in which of the following organizations? A. Future Group, D. B. DMart, C. Reliance Retail, D. VMart, and E. None of the above. So what is the answer? Saudi Arabia's public investment fund is investing Good job, guys, and it is less retail. So Saudi Arabia's PIF for public investment fund is planning to invest in Reliance Retail. So it's going to pick up 2.04% stake in Mukesh Ambani's Reliance Retail Ventures, and it is becoming the latest high-profile global fund to purchase a stake in India's largest in retailer. So very, very important. And the headquarters of Reliance Retail is in Mumbai, and the current MD and CEO of Reliance Retail is Mr. Damodar Mall, right? Reliance Retail Ventures Limited is MD and CEO is Mr. Damodar Mall. Next question is, of the following leading stock exchange launched Corp Direct, a direct investment portal for corporates. Again, an important question, which is that leading stock exchange which has launched this Corp Direct, a direct investment portal for the corporates recently? BSE, NSE, India International Exchange, Ahmedabad Stock Exchange, E, none of the above. The answer is A, BSE, Bombay Stock Exchange launches this Corp Direct portal for the corporate. So, as you see, leading stock exchange BSE launched this Corp Direct, a direct investment portal for the corporate. It has got a lot of features, which is going to simplify this value-based services that are going to be provided to the asset management companies, distributors, investors, mutual fund industry participant. All of them are going to be benefited with this Corp Direct portal. And what are the services that it is going to be providing? End-to-end digital web module, quick onboarding for corporates who are already transacting, and also all the asset management companies and schemes will be now available under one portal of Corp Direct. SMS and email confirmation, multiple transactions with a single click, availability of multiple payment options, all of these are integrated into this Corp Direct portal. And here you have to remember that BSE is headquartered in Mumbai, a very simple thing to remember. And the current chairman of BSE is Mr. Vikramajit Sen, and the MD and CEO of BSE is Ashish Kumar Chauhan. Both become important, chairman being Vikramajit Sen and MD and CEO is Ashish Kumar Chauhan, which can be asked in phase one of the examination. Next question, which of the following becomes the first corporate partner of edX from India to offer this massive open online courses? A, TCS, B, ICICI Bank, C, Infosys, D, SBI, E, RBI. So which is partnering with edX from India to offer this MOOC, which is massive open online courses? The answer is D, SBI Bank. Good job, some of you. So SBI becomes the first corporate partner of edX, which is a online platform. SBI becomes the first corporate partner from India to collaborate with edX to offer this massive open online courses, which have been gaining traction after the COVID pandemic. As you see, most of the education and the courses have been shifting online, right? So here the bank is going to offer initially three courses. One is Unleashing Creativity at the Workplace. Two, Relationship Marketing Strategy for Financial Services. Third course is on the conflict resolution. You don't have to know about all of these in detail. What becomes more important is which bank or becomes the first corporate partner with edX. And we know that the SBI chairman is currently Mr. Dinesh Kumar Khara, and the headquarters of edX is at United States, and the current MD and CEO of edX India is Mr. Anant Agarwal, right? Next question, SBI signed an MOU with which of the following country stock exchange to promote green finance? Important question. So SBI signed MOU or Memorandum of Understanding with which of the following countries stock exchange? A, Netherlands, B, Luxembourg, C, Sweden, D, Switzerland, and E, none of the above. The answer is yes, B, Luxembourg. Very, very important. This is a country in Europe, and its stock exchange has recently signed this Memorandum of Understanding with SBI to promote green finance mechanism. So it's going to be a long-term cooperation mechanism, and they're going to focus on environmental, social, corporate governance, and also green finance, right? So I already discussed about the SBI chairman and the headquarters. Next question, Mercedes-Benz joins hands with which of the following bank to target high net worth individual customers? A phase one straightforward question. So in Mercedes-Benz joins hands with which of the following banks? Yes. So a lot of questions on SBI Bank. Mercer's Bank joined hands with SBI Bank to target the HNI or high net worth individual customer. And this collaboration will give the luxury automobile manufacturer an access to the SBI's HNI customer base, while the bank's customers will enjoy exclusive benefits at the same time for booking a Mercedes-Benz car, right? And the current Mercedes managing director and CEO is Mr. Martin Schwenk. Next question, which of the following banks signs MOU or Memorandum of Understanding with Inventive Pruner Chamber of Commerce and Industries, ICCI? It's not ICICI, ICCI, standing for Inventive Pruner Chamber of Commerce and Industries. And this collaboration is going to support the SMEs and startups. So which bank has recently signed an MOU with ICCI? Can we have the answers quickly? Good job, guys. It is HDFC Bank. Fantastic. So HDFC Bank signs an MOU with Inventive Pruner Chamber of Commerce and Industries to support SMEs and startups. Lot of initiatives between various organizations aiming to strengthen the SMEs and startups, because these are the segment which create a lot of employment opportunities, and they have been the worst affected because of the pandemic, right? So here, HDFC Bank has signed an MOU with Inventive Pruner Chamber of Commerce and Industries to mainly support SMEs and startups. And this association, through this association, you will see that ICICI will be engaging, enrolling, and supporting various startups, SMEs, and MSMEs to facilitate this facilities from the HDFC Bank. So ICICI will be providing the startup names, SME names, to the HDFC Bank, and the HDFC Bank will be together conducting diverse networking activities, awareness camp, interactive sessions for these entities. And you have to remember here that Inventive Pruner Chamber of Commerce and Industries is the biggest platform to support entrepreneurship globally that is operational, and it is headquartered in New Delhi. A very, very important question. Right, where is the headquarters of ICCI? It is in New Delhi, and the current MD and CEO of ICCI is Ms. Ritika Yadav. Right. So what is the role of HDFC? As we have seen, it's going to create awareness camps for these prospective startups and SMEs that ICCI is going to recommend, and it will also offer key business support functions, like it can provide shared workspaces, digital marketing services, web services, patent filing services for startups and also SMEs, and content writing, tax and legal advisory services to all the recommended businesses of ICCI. Next question, which of the following personalities joined the global investment firm Carlyle as the senior advisor recently? A. Shashidhar Jagdishan, B. Rakesh Sharma, C. T. N. Manoharan, D. Rajesh Kumar Chibbar, E. Aditya Puri. So what is the answer? It is Aditya Puri has joined as the senior advisor for the global investment firm Carlyle. And who is Aditya Puri? He is the former HDFC Bank CEO. And the current CEO is Mr. Shashidhar Jagdishan, right? So the former CEO has joined Carlyle as the senior advisor. So please remember which firm he has joined, Carlyle. This is also important, and it is headquartered in Washington. He will be providing guidance on the evolving market landscape and also suggesting the new investment opportunities to the firm across Asia. Next question. Citigroup Inc. has announced Dash as the head of its global consumer bank. A. Anand Silva, B. Bill Winter, C. Zarin Daruwala, D. Ajay Pal, Ajay Singh Banga, and E. None of the above. So Citigroup Inc. has got a new head for its global consumer bank, and who is he? Yeah, I'm extremely sorry for this. It is A. Anand Silva, right? So Citigroup Inc. has got Mr. Anand Silva as the head of its global consumer bank. Very, very important. Can be asked. So Citigroup appointed Anand Silva as the global head of the consumer banking, and he will be appointed to this post from January 2021 onwards, after it was left vacant by Mr. Jane Fraser, who is the head currently. So you have to remember that Citigroup is headquartered in New York, United States, and the current CEO of Citigroup is Mr. Michael Corbett, and the global head for consumer banking is going to be an Indian, and it is Mr. Anand Silva. Next question. Cholamandalam Investment and Finance Corporation Limited, a Murugappa Group firm, has recently appointed Dash as the chairman, right? So A, M.M. Murugappan, B, Ajay Pal, Ajay Singh Banga, C, Velayan Subbaiah, D, A.K. Gupta, and E, none of the above. So who becomes the chairman of the Cholamandalam Investment and Finance Company? It is C, guys, right? So Velayan Subbaiah, some of you answered correctly, good job. So Velayan Subbaiah has recently become the chairman of Cholamandalam Investment and Finance Company. So earlier it was M.M. Murugappan who was the chairman of Cholamandalam Investment Finance, and he is now retiring and is going to step down. And that is the reason the recent chairman is Mr. Velayan Subbaiah. And you have to note here that the headquarters of Cholamandalam Finance is in Chennai, and the MD and CEO is going to be Mr. Murugappan itself, but the chairman is Mr. Velayan Subbaiah. Next question, which of the following personalities has been appointed as MD and CEO by HDFC Mutual Fund? A. Saurabh Nanavati, B. Rajiv Jalota, C. Milind Barve, D. Navneet Munot, E. None of the above. So who has been appointed as the MD and CEO of HDFC Mutual Fund? What is the answer for this? Yes, Manjot, what is the answer? It is Navneet Munot, right? So Mr. Navneet Munot has been appointed as the MD and CEO of HDFC Mutual Fund. So he is going to succeed Milind Barve. And Mr. Navneet Munot was earlier a CIO at SBI Mutual Fund, and now he'll be appointed for the HDFC Asset Management Company, right? So you have to know that the HDFC Asset Management Company is headquartered at Mumbai, right? This is one of the important things that we have to note. Most of the firms are headquartered in Mumbai. Next question, RBI's new innovation hub, RBIH, which aims to promote advancement in financial sector using technology, will be chaired by A. Amitabh Kant, B. Chris Gopalakrishnan, C. Amitabh Chaudhary, D. Ajay Bhushan Prasad, E. None of the above. So who is going to be chairing? Yes. Gyanu Mishra, you've done a correct job. Yes. What is the answer for this? It is B. Nilesh has done the correct job. It is Chris Gopalakrishnan who is going to be chairing the RBI's Innovation Hub. So Chris Gopalakrishnan is the co-founder of Infosys, and he'll be chairing the RBI's Innovation Hub. And what is the aim of the RBI Innovation Hub? It is going to promote the advancement in the financial sector using technology. So all kind of fintech innovations will be promoted by RBI Innovation Hub. And it will be guided by the Governing Council, which will be headed by Mr. Chris Gopalakrishnan, right? And as you have seen, some of the important areas that the Innovation Hub is going to look after is, it is going to develop internal infrastructure so that the fintech research and it is also going can be promoted, and at the same time it is going to promote the engagement with innovators and startups. It is going to collaborate with the financial tech sector institutions, tech industry and academic institution, and bringing a coordination between all these actors so that ideas and can be exchanged between them, and a proper prototype related to the financial innovations can be created. On the whole, it tries to promote the fintech innovation ecosystem in the country, right? Next question, in which of the following years was Exim Bank established through? Sorry, it is through which of the following acts Exim Bank was established? A. Exim Bank Act of 1980, Exim Bank Act of 1990, Exim Bank Act of 1981, D. Exim Bank Act of 1991, E. None of the above. What do you think is the answer? It's a static question also. And the answer is C. Sorry guys, I've not mentioned here. It is the C. Exim Bank Act 1981. Establishes Exim Bank. So it is a statutory body, right? Whenever an organization is established through an act or a legislation, it is called a statutory body. So you have to note here that it is set up by an act of a parliament, that is Exim Bank Act of 1981, and it is a wholly owned subsidiary of Government of India. It commenced its operations in 1982, and it is an apex financial institution with respect to exports and imports in the country. And why was it in news? Recently, Mr. N. Ramesh has taken charge as the Deputy Managing Director of the Exim Bank. Very, very important. And earlier, he was serving as Director in Department of Commerce at the center. And now he's going to be taking charge as the Deputy Managing Director of Exim Bank. Right? So here you have to remember, Exim Bank is a statutory body set up through an act of the parliament, that is the Exim Bank Act of 1981. And what is it going to look under? It is going to provide the financial assistance to the exporters and importers, and also going to be functioning as the principal financial institution that is going to coordinate for the various institutions that are working in the domain of export and import business. Right? And it's going to protect the public interest. Next question, who among the following was appointed as the CMD of the National Scheduled Caste Finance and Development Corporation, NSFDC? Who was recently appointed as the CMD of National Scheduled Caste Finance and Development Corporation? A. Dinesh Kumar Khara, B. Madhav Nair, C. Rakesh Sharma, D. Raj Kiran Rai Ji, and E. Rajneesh K. Jinnah. So who has been appointed as the CMD of NSFDC recently? The answer is E. Rajneesh K. Jinnah. Right? Rajneesh K. Jinnah is the NSFDC CMD, which was appointed recently. So there's nothing more important with respect to the current affairs, but you have to know that NSFDC was incorporated by the Government of India in the year 1988. And again, it is a fully owned Government of India company, which was set up under the Section 8 of the Companies Act, right? It's a statutory body having the strength of a legislation, having the support of a legislation, that is the Companies Act of 2013. It's a company incorporated under the Companies Act. And you have to remember here that though it says that earlier it was a scheduled caste and scheduled tribes finance development corporation when it was incorporated, but later it was bifurcated into two separate corporations, and now currently it is only looking after the scheduled caste finance, right? It is not going to take care of the scheduled tribes finance, which is now again looked after by a separate body, and this happened in the year 2001. So from the static point of view, you have to make a note of this important points, right? So thank you so much, guys. We are done with the part 2 of the November month current affairs, and we'll be completing the November month current affairs in a part 3 video too. And soon we'll also be coming up with a quick revision series for the general knowledge or the current affairs section, which can improve your revision for the SEBI grade examination. Okay, so we have one more question, guys. Sorry for that. And which of the following Indian company has been voted as the most outstanding company financial sector in India by Asia Money? Sorry for this. So quickly, can we have the answer for this? Which Indian company has been voted as the most outstanding company by Asia Money recently? A. Tata Capital, B. ICICI, C. HDFC, D. L&T. I'm sure the answer is very simple. Lot of accolades for HDFC in the current year, and HDFC has got that most outstanding company in the financial sector category by Asia Money. Right, Asia Money asked the participants in the poll to consider the company's overall performance, and it is going to poll in two categories. One is by country wise and another is by sector wise, and HDFC has bagged this honor for the second consecutive year, and it is covering 12 markets across Asia: China, Hong Kong, India, Indonesia, Korea, Malaysia, Pakistan, Philippines, Singapore, Taiwan, Thailand, and Vietnam. 12 markets are covered by Asia Money, and HDFC is a proud sector of India, which is bagged this honor for the second time consecutively. So I want every one of you to make a note that Olive Board has got exclusive courses which can strengthen your preparation for SEBI grade examination. And you will get video lessons for paper 2, detailed study notes for paper 2, monthly current affairs capsule, topic-wise tests, and also All India mock tests. You can use this coupon code of P30, which will help you get the courses at 30% discount. Thank you so much, guys. Make a note of all the upcoming events, the revision series that is going ahead for economics. We have already completed the same for the Finance Management and the Companies Act too. And you will get the playlist for all of these in the Olive Board channel. So apart from this, we are having this current affairs lecture series for SEBI Grade A Phase 1 of the examination every Wednesday at 7 p.m. and also the Government Scheme lecture series for RBA Grade 2 Phase 2 every Thursday at 8:30 p.m. and you will find the links for all of these in the description box below. Thank you so much, guys. If you found the video useful, please hit the like button. And if you want to stay updated with respect to the exam preparation process, please subscribe to All About Channel. Have a great learning experience, guys.